And our keynote speaker of the afternoon, Mr. Jay Frye. Well, Jay, you've come a long way from Rock Island, Illinois, young man. First of all, thank you very much for joining us here at the Racetrack Business Conference.
Well, obviously, my pleasure. Thank you all for having me. Welcome to Indy. Sorry, I have to have this cough drop. I don't know if any of you are from here, but there's definitely something going around, which is a lot of fun. So it takes like a month to get over it. I'm about halfway there, I hope. So,
very.
Yeah. Very. I gotta admit, so apologize for that.
Very good. Why motorsports? Of all the things you could have done in your life, why motorsports?
Well, I went to University of Missouri, and my first job out of college, I worked for Anheuser-Busch, which was... I worked for Anheuser-Busch, and I was fortunate enough to meet some people in motorsports in that area. From there, I went to and worked and ran Valvoline's motorsports program, and at that point, I met Rick Hendrick, and that's when we were fortunate enough to start a cup team from scratch in 1996 with some help from our friends at Chevrolet and Mr. Herb Fischel sitting right there. So Rick was very instrumental in, you know, everything I did in the motorsports world and in NASCAR. And now we ended up here.
What have been the biggest differences that you've encountered professionally between the NASCAR world and the IndyCar world?
To me, they're very similar. I mean, a lot of, you know, as we all know, everything we do is about the people. So a lot of the people are the same. We got teams that are the same. So there's really not been that big a difference. You know, it's so much about the people. You got, you know, different kind of cars, different, but the way we run race procedures are very similar. A lot of the technological pieces are very similar. So it wasn't as different as I thought it would be.
Technology side of things being what it is, you came into NASCAR at a time that, you know, technology was first starting to really be noticed. Now it's like Formula One with fenders there. And, of course, IndyCar's always been all about the technology for so many years. Does technology make better racing? Does higher technology make better racing? Or do you have to be careful of balancing that act?
But I think you certainly need to be careful. In 96, when we started the Cup team I was referencing to, it was called MB2 Motorsports. Back originally, it was Ernie Irvin and Skittles, Kenny Schrader, M&Ms, Mark Martin in the Army, Joe Nemechek in the Army. When we started in 96, we had an 8,000 square foot building with 13 full time people. That was great. So back then, you had five people do, or one person do five jobs. 10 years later, that team ended up being a three car Cup team and a one car Busch team, or Nationwide team at that point. We had 180 people in a 180,000 square foot building. So what was the difference? Well, the difference at that point was you had five people do one job. So the sport became very, you know, much more specialized, and that's good. I mean, it's good for the economy. It's good for employment. I think the technology piece you have to be careful though, because you can go too far where the return ends up being not what you need. You know, where it becomes so expensive, how much does it really change the product? And I think that's what you're seeing right now in some forms of motorsports. The costs have far outweighed the benefit of what they're doing, and they're starting to have to probably bring that back, and it's really hard to bring something back.
I went to a NASCAR test not too long ago, and I was amazed that there are more engineers now than there are people actually working on the cars. And in addition to rules costing money, which that's the number one thing that old racers always tell me, that more rules cost more money, more technology costs more money. But when it comes to technology, can you ever put that genie back in the bottle?
Well, again, that's, I think, what you're seeing. You're right. The smaller the box, the more expensive the box is. Because, again, there's, you know, teams are going to do what they can to figure out that really small box to get that much more of a benefit. I think it's going to be hard. I mean, we were fortunate enough last year. We come up with a 5-year plan, so we stopped the manufacturer's aero kits. This year we're coming, or in 18 we're going to have a universal car. The universal car, we think, looks more like an IndyCar is supposed to look, which, you know, it's kind of, it has a very historical feel, but it's very forward-looking. So as a race team, we know, or they know, they're going to run that car for 18, 19, and 20. So there's 3 of the 5 years they have that car. So you can plan that out. We have Dallara's, our manufacturers of the chassis. Right now they have more cars on order than they have since they first started. So that is a good indicator of health of the sport. Another thing is we have 3 or 4 new teams coming into IndyCar in 2018. So, you know, new teams, new cars being manufactured, great support from Chevrolet and Honda. So, again, I think, you know, we've had this plan. At the end of next year, we'll decide what's going to happen in 21. So we always stay 3 years ahead. So as a race team or as a league, the teams can plan and prepare for where we're going. So they know what we're doing. And they had great input on what is happening. So they're part of the solution.
Did it answer the question?
Perfectly, not. Yeah. So you actually did. You're really good at this.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Hardly.
I'm an old school Indy fan myself. You know, I started watching the sport, you know, when I was a little kid, back when the cars all did look different. And that's the biggest complaint that I hear. Yeah. And when I hear old school fans like myself complain about that, I say, but doggone it, the racing's pretty doggone good, isn't it?
Yeah.
I don't know if this is the golden age, I think, of Indy racing. Yeah, the cars looked cooler maybe back in the 60s and 70s, but I'm not so sure the racing was any better.
Yeah, no, I think that's a great point. If you look a few years ago when we started the manufacturer aero kit program, the cars were vastly different to start. And then as couple years went on, the cars became more and more alike. And the reason was that they both figured out what they were doing, and hey, that's better, and then they made it similar. So I think if you look through the history of the sport, even when there was multiple chassis manufacturers, multiple things, a lot of times the cars got kind of alike because they all saw what each other were doing. So what we've tried to do is kind of reset the whole thing and you know, go back to our history of what an Indy car is supposed to look like. The rear wheels are exposed. A lot of people have asked if we changed, you know, are the tires in the back bigger on this new car? They're not. It's just that you haven't seen them for a couple of years or a few years. So now you can see them. So we're, you know, America's open wheel series. Well, the car is an open wheel car again. That's what it's supposed to be. So a lot of the downforce has been removed. It's not a point and click car. When we tested this car, we had Juan Montoya drove the Chevrolet and Oriol Servia drove the Honda. And we did 4 tests with them. Each time at the end of they would come in and get out of the car, they would have these huge smiles on their face. And they were very excited about this car because they were driving it. It was fun to drive. It would slide through the corners. In the corners, you could hear the tires squeal. You could just see the difference. So we're thinking this car will put it much more in the driver's hands, you know, which not just with removing all the downforce that we have. So we're excited about it.
For many years in your professional life, I'm sure that like a lot of us, you were griping about the guy at the top running the series. And you were sitting there saying how much smarter you would be.
Absolutely.
If you were running the show. Now that you're running the show, you know, see, I had a similar experience growing up. I thought my dad was an idiot.
Right.
And then when I got older, I realized how smart he was.
Yeah.
What have you learned from your past experience, though, that helps you relate to those owners that tend to whine a little bit?
Yeah. Well, I think coming from a team, the team perspective was very important because, again, there are our biggest stakeholders. If we don't have teams, we don't have a series, we don't have a sport. So, again, having the new teams coming in this year is a big thing. So that makes us feel like, you know, we've got the right direction going. That's really it. It's funny, in the NASCAR days, when I would have those thoughts, like, you know, what are they doing? You know, this is crazy, that type of thing. Really, 6 months later, you'd figure out that was the right call, right? So after a while, you learned that they know what they're doing. I mean, you might not exactly agree with it at the time, but ultimately it's the right way to go down the road. So hopefully with our teams, you know, we've been in this role for a couple of years, they're part of all the decisions we make. And again, ultimately we have to decide, but we've got some very, very smart people in our paddock and we try to make sure we get as much input as we can from them. And then once we get all the information, then we decide. But they understand if we don't go the direction they wanted to, they understand why we didn't. And, you know, at the end of the day. So, we seem to be going in a good way right now with that.
When I was learning about things in life, a famous philosopher had words of wisdom that, You know, I still remember to this day, guy's name was Dan Gurney.
Oh, yeah.
Dan Gurney. He talked about the relationship between horsepower and downforce and what makes great racing. Are the old Dan Gurney rules, are they still applicable today? And how does that apply to what you're trying to do with this new rule package with Indy this year?
Absolutely. One of the, you know, we talk to, again, lots of people in our paddock. Rick Mears is around all the time, and I have great respect for him. Dan, you know, there's lots of them, but Rick was always one. You know, if you can go in the turn and not lift, that's probably a problem. You know, you got to, you know, so there's something going on. So our cars were really to the point where they weren't having to lift much or at all. So this new car, they're going to have to lift, and it's going to create a whole different passing opportunity. The braking zones will change. You know, that's one piece. The other piece is we're about ready to announce some different things with the engine program going forward. So there should be substantially more horsepower coming in a couple of years too. So that's the next piece of this car. So again, it's we've taken all the information we can, and you know the downforce removal it just gotten too much. So reducing that overall will help a bunch.
The speedway racing though has been just breathtaking. In IndyCar, the road course racing has been road course racing, and the street course racing has been the type of racing you expect. Why, other than the Indianapolis 500, do we have troubles gaining more fans to watch oval racing nowadays in the U.S.?
Well, that's it's a great question. I don't know if any of you saw the Texas race. I mean, it's spectacular. The Indy 500 obviously is still a lot, and lots of people watch that, but we're looking into that. It is a breathtaking. It's funny how during the race, you know, other drivers from other forms of motorsports are tweeting about, oh, this is crazy, this is unbelievable, what's going on. So they see it, lots of fans see it. We did this year have a nice gain in attendance at Texas, which was good. Phoenix is very important to us. There's going to be some new things going on there. Iowa, great Midwestern venue. We need to get that moved back to Saturday night. You know, Sunday at 5:00 is not a good time, which we're working on. St. Louis had a great crowd. I mean, phenomenal crowd. We hadn't been there in, you know, 10 years. There were, you know, the grandstands were packed. It was really cool. Lots of enthusiasm. So I think we can get that back. I think, you know, part of you've seen the last few years, see the 500s come back a lot. You know, and not that it ever went far away, but it come back to full song a couple years ago. So. The oval racing, it's spectacular. That's, I guess, the only way to sum it up.
What's your biggest challenge facing you as we move forward that has you the most worried?
We're not really worried. I think right now we have some opportunities. I think when you mentioned about cost and benefits, I think we've got a good program put together for the next, you know, 5, 6, or really through probably 2027-ish. I think the revenue side of the business has got to, you know, change a little bit, which could be really, that could help a lot. We're working really hard to have another OEM partner manufacturer come in with great help with Chevrolet and Honda. We got two really good ones, but a third would benefit the whole league, and Chevrolet and Honda are helping a lot with that. So we're optimistic about that. And I would say that's our next biggest challenge. Robbie's got his TV piece. We got the OEM piece. If we can hit a couple things, you know, going forward, I think we'll be in really good shape.
From an IndyCar fan's perspective, the sport tried to self-destruct a number of years ago. But ladies and gentlemen, with the good leadership here from Mr. Jay Frye, I think better years are ahead for IndyCar racing. And I think 2018, we're going to see some magnificent racing on the track. Ladies and gentlemen, Mr. Jay Frye.
Well, thank you. Thank you for having me. Thank you very much. Good to see you. Thank you.